Hi, I'm Thomas Knox. I'm the creator of Date While You Ain't, and I'm from Brooklyn, New York.
What was your last 9-to-5?
My last 9-to-5 was me working for a technology company, a rather large one here in New York.
And what were you doing there?
I do business sit-ups and business support. So essentially what that means is I help customers develop great solutions for their computers and for their business.
How has your job working at this 9-to-5 technology company helped you to transition into being your own boss per se, or starting your own project for Date While You Wait?
It hasn't helped me in any way whatsoever. It hasn't done anything for me other than giving me money to put in my pocket.
What about customer service, customer care?
Absolutely not.
Nothing?
Well, that one, if anything, it made me want to leave work and run into like the train station faster.
Yeah. Well, that's good.
Nothing.
How has juggling your job been with pursuing your passion project?
Juggling my job has been pretty easy. I work a typical 9-to-5, so normally I do Date While You Wait on weekdays after work or during the weekends, which I'm normally off.
So tell people exactly what Date While You Wait is and how you started.
Date While You Wait is a movement I created to connect with people while they commute. I noticed that there was a lot of negative energy that goes on within the subway when you travel. So I wanted to do something positive. And that was just sit down, have a great conversation, invite people to have great interactions before they go home or on their way to work, and kind of take it from there.
Did you go through something specific in your life that, you know, make a light bulb go off in your head to say you wanted to start this business? How did that happen?
Absolutely. So Date While You Wait, when I first started, it wasn't a business. It was just essentially a movement or a conversation starter. And the events that got me, or that led up to it for me to do something like this was, I had a conversation with a friend about how her commute was on her way home, and she was just telling me how no matter what she was doing, there was always something negative going on. So the first car she got into, there was a homeless person. The second car she got into, there was people playing music. The third car she got into, there were people panhandling. Like, she just wanted to get home. And I was like, well, I'm just going to do something where I have great conversation with people if they want to have those types of conversations on their way home with a cassette, on their way to work.
How was your first day on the job, per se, of Date While You Wait? How was that?
So the first time I did Date While You Wait was incredible. The biggest thing that happened was I met about 20 people and I didn't use anything but myself. So there was no board games, there was no flowers, it was just me, a table, two chairs, Coke bottle, and one flower for decoration, but it was just for conversation. There was nothing else other than that, and I met a pretty decent amount of people around it. So,
from a business standpoint, would you consider yourself an entrepreneur?
At this point, looking at what Date While You Wait or the potential of what Date While You Wait can be, yes, it can definitely be more of a business, but I think it's going to be more so around of developing people. Whereas when I first started, there was nothing around that, it was just conversation. Now I realize that people really, really love and appreciate human interaction and human connection, so that was something that I see I can do from a business perspective.
What's one of the biggest, or who is one of your biggest connectors that you've connected with so far, you know, doing this project?
My biggest connector would definitely be Howard Wexler, who is the creator of Connect4. He read an article about me in the New York Times and reached out, and he's kind of like my mentor now, so I connect with him like once or twice a month just to kind of touch base and get his insight on how I can better develop Date While You Wait as a business.
New York City is a really tough town. Were you shocked the way you were perceived so positively from doing this? Like, were you in shock that, you know, people were happy to see that you were doing it and also participating? Like, were you shocked by that at all?
No, not at all. The reason I wasn't shocked was because everybody has goodness in them. And I think a lot of times when you're doing something like this, people do it because people can be negative. And I understand that being a New Yorker, where we have people look at us as negative people, we have negative attitudes. And I totally disagree. I think everybody has something that they want to share. Everybody has you know, positivity in them. Everybody has goodness in them. So all the love that I've been getting, I just feel like I'm pulling out the goodness that are in people that they always kind of wanted to let out.
Through your mission, you have come in contact with all different kind of people, different races, ages, sex, everything different. How do you think your mission would be for the world if it was televised? Like, you're in one subway for a couple of hours. How do you think your vision would be if it was televised to the world? How would it make a difference?
I think it'd be well received. It's definitely, so it's funny you ask that question because it's definitely been televised to the world before. So, and it was well received because everybody has projects and ideas that they want to work on. And sometimes you just need the encouragement to do it. I look at my company, I look at it as something where I give people the encouragement, I give people the hope and the faith to go out and do something that they're interested in. That it can be the smallest idea, but you never know how successful it can be until you try. And I measure success on just doing it. So no matter what happens, whether I meet one person or I meet 500 people, at the end of the day, I do the project. So that's a successful attempt for me.
How important is it to love what you do? How important is it to be passionate about what you do?
That's funny. It's a funny question. Because it's extremely important, right? But what's the sense of doing something if you're not passionate about it or you don't love what you do? That just doesn't make any sense. I think looking at anything you can do in the world, if you want to be an athlete or a writer, or if you want to be an astronaut, if you look at all those types of professions, those people love in some way what they do. And then obviously when it gets to a business point, it can sometimes change and dwindle, but absolutely you have to love what you do in order to be successful at it.
Your company is based on human connections. So how has social media, which is so far from what you're looking forward to, you know, doing, how has that helped your business?
Honestly, social media, if it wasn't with social media, Date While You Wait wouldn't be as popular as it is. So social media definitely played a huge part in getting the story out to the world. So I think looking at it from a perspective of putting the product in people's hands, I have people from all over the world who reach out to me, you know, from Australia, from India, from France, all over the world, like countless countries, who have reached out to me and asked me, hey, can I do this in my country or my school or with my friends? So I think social media plays a huge part because it just brings visibility to what you're doing. And for me, people really, really get, you know, they have great feelings when they see me do something like sitting in a subway talking to an older gentleman or sitting in a subway talking to, you know, a person of a different race. So I think just creating great, great opportunities for people to see what you're doing from a visibility standpoint, that's exactly what social media has created for me.
What do you see for yourself, Thomas Knox, also for Date While You Wait, but separate for Thomas Knox? Like, where do you see yourself and your project going?
Oh, well, Date While You Wait is we're working on some app stuff so that there's an app in the works. We're also doing more events, more like live events and, you know, events where people can come and kind of mingle and play games and connect. So that's what's coming in the near future for Date While You Wait. Me personally, I work on a lot of nonprofit stuff, so I work with a lot of youth. My passion is connecting with young men of color. So a lot of my time outside of Date While You Wait and outside of work is working on developing platforms for young men to have resources around mental health, around learning about finances, around chivalry, around, you know, pretty much anything that has to do with developing young men, I kind of work on, and I have a team of people that we're developing something. So, personally for myself, my I guess where I'm headed is to create opportunities for young men of color to be able to do things like this, or projects like this, just like I do.
So if people
want to
catch you, find you, or they
want to
date while they wait,
yeah,
where do they go?
Hey, don't look for me.
I'm
good.
No, they will look for you, especially after this interview.
I'm good. No.
Where can they find you?
I can be found on a subway near you. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. So Facebook, I can be found on Facebook, on Twitter, Instagram, all under Date While You Wait, fully spelled out.